أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله بارئ الخلائق أجمعين، مبير الظالمين، صريخ المستصرخين، ثم الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء وسيد المرسلين وحبيب إله العالمين، الخاتم لما سبق والفاتح لما استقبل والمهيمن على ذلك كله، المدفون بالمدينة صاحب السكينة أبي القاسم محمد. وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المكرمين الغر الميامين، سيما بقية الله في الأراضين وحجته على الخلائق أجمعين، سيدنا وإمام زماننا وصاحب نعمتنا، مهدي هذه الأمة وطاووس أهل الجنة، الحجة بن الحسن العسكري، فداه أرواح العالمين. قال الله الحكيم في محكم كتابه الكريم، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: من عمل صالحا من ذكر أو أنثى وهو مؤمن فلنحيينه حياة طيبة. آمنا بالله، صدق الله العلي العظيم. One of the key words in the vocabulary of a scientist is wonder. The response evoked by the marvelous sophistication and sheer beauty of the physical world around us. If you take a look at the world in which we live, you will notice, first of all, that everything is in order. The entire world is but a perfect input-output system, an I/O system. It is perfect. If there are problems, it's because the input had a problem. If there is good, it's because the input was good. And that's why the output turns out to be good. And I'll talk about that in the subsequent nights, inshallah. When we respond to the fallacy of some of the atheists that tell you God doesn't exist because there's evil in the world. But for now, you look at the world and you notice that everything is in order, everything's beautiful. You notice that everything is on a constant change. The only constant, it seems, in the world is that there is no constant. Things change from one state to another. And things also exist. That's something as obvious as it seems that we never think about. There are things around us. I exist. This room exists. You exist. We all exist. Now, when you look at a painting, a work of art, a masterpiece, say by Leonardo da Vinci or Picasso, you look at that painting and the first thing you realize is that the painting has an artist. And so you ask about the artist's name. Who was the artist? If you walked into a gallery and you saw a really beautiful painting displayed and you asked the organizers of the gallery who the painter, who the artist was, and they told you, well, there really is no artist. This, you know, just came about by accident. You would probably just walk out of the gallery. That's a ludicrous thing to say. That is stupid, to say the very least. If this is a beautiful painting, then it must have someone with the abilities to create it. It must have someone, first of all. Second of all, that someone must possess certain qualities such as being an artist, such as having a vast experience in the field of art, such as being able to use, you know, different colors and paints and different tools to come with that painting as the final result. It is amazing how institutional science, and I want to talk about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because I have made this a habit of mine to talk about Allah in every series of lectures, because I think belief in Tawheed, belief in Allah the Almighty and the All-Merciful, is the bedrock of Islamic faith. It is the foundation, it's the basis. Without it, nothing else can stand. And so I try to devote at least one speech to that topic. It is amazing how institutional science would invest billions of dollars into programs such as the SETI. And what they do, they try to find living creatures and life in outer space. They invest billions, even governments, you know, chip in some of their budgets into these projects and into these programs. They try to discover life in outer space. And they conclude that indeed there is life in outer space if they detect two prime numbers. You know, such a small and insignificant thing, two prime numbers. When they see such a phenomenon, they conclude that there is indeed life in outer space. Yet these same people, the people of institutional science, I'm not attacking all scientists categorically, but there are scientific institutions with that mindset that refuse to debate scientists with extensive mathematical evidence for the existence of God and for creation in the DNA, for example. Incidentally, you probably know that the two scientists that discovered the human genome, that they first mapped the human genome, they concluded, notice, you know, this is as funny as it is, it really is ludicrous. They concluded that the DNA, in all of its sophistication and complexity, the human DNA and humankind in general, and every living creature, because they all have DNA, were created by aliens coming from outer space. So, I mean, when they see complexity, they say it could be aliens, it could be chance, it could be a supermassive explosion, it could be Mother Nature, it could be Uncle Sam, but they will never tell you that it's God Almighty. Because of all the arrogance that they have. Because once they concede that there is God and there is a creator and there is an omnipotent, omniscient being out there that controls everything, once they conclude, once they reach that conclusion, then there will be a maze of all new question marks that will pop up and they will need to answer each and every one of them. And then they will also have to submit to this being. They will also have to seek knowledge of this being. And so they stay out of that. They stay away and they tell you it was aliens that you know, created living creatures on this planet. Just imagine if an archaeologist, for example, a renowned archaeologist, makes the ludicrous claim that the pyramids of Egypt, for example, the pyramids of Giza, they were not created by intelligent human beings, but rather they were created by those giant rocks accidentally rolling on top of each other, creating those complex structures. If an archaeologist made that claim, he will become the laughing stock of the scientific community, and he will lose his job, to say the very least. And a person like that should really be taken to a mental institution. A person who makes such a claim is, to put it in plain layman terms, an idiot. So why is it that when we look at this world with its sheer beauty, complexity, sophistication, order, subhanAllah, if someone said to you, for some reason, sometimes we're looked at as people who go against science and don't accept scientific exploration as a means of reaching conclusions and so forth. But if someone said to you that there is no God, then you should tell them that you yourself are basing your beliefs on blind faith and that you are going against hard science. Why? Because that makes them believe that the world has always existed as a perpetual motion machine, and that by itself is against the two first laws of thermodynamics. A rock, my friends, cannot make itself. Do we need a PhD to explain this? Can a rock make itself from non-existence? No. And a fire can't burn forever. Again, do we need a master's degree for that? A fire needs energy. Energy is limited. And so a fire can only burn for a certain amount of time. Now that time could be 5 billion years, such as the sun. It burns and burns and burns, but we all know that the sun will eventually cease to exist. The fire will extinguish. And you will recognize these two from the first two laws of thermodynamics. The law of the conservation of matter and energy, and the increase in entropy. A rock cannot make itself. And so when you look at a building, the first thing you will ask yourself is, where's the builder? You know that there's a builder. And if someone said to you that there is no builder, if someone said to you that this painting doesn't have an artist, if someone told you that this microphone doesn't have a manufacturer, if someone told you that this hotel doesn't have an architect, you would laugh at them. You will think that they are going against hard science and that they base their views on blind faith. It is we that encourage others to go and search through science to find God. Islam never had a conflict with science. In fact, scientists in the Islamic world always flourished, and they enjoyed the backing and support of the Islamic states all along. Unlike the dogmatic religious authorities in Europe, for example, in medieval Europe, where people such as Galileo had to be persecuted simply because they expressed their scientific views, such a thing never took place in the Islamic world. Because Islam is a religion that says, go, learn, seek, discover, and come to understanding. This is why the Prophet says, طَلَبُ الْعِلْمِ فَرِيضَةٌ عَلَى كُلِّ مُسْلِمٍ وَمُسْلِمٍ. It is an obligation upon every Muslim man and every Muslim woman to go and seek knowledge. It was not only not discouraged, it was encouraged and it was made into an obligation. This is why we as Muslims must try to base our beliefs, as I explained last night very briefly, on hard evidence. And if that happens, you can rest assured that a Muslim man and a Muslim woman will not be swayed and deviated. Take this example. If you had a piece of paper, take a piece of paper, put it on your palm, and blow at it, what's going to happen? It'll fly off, right? Now, try the same scenario, except this time, put a set of keys on that piece of paper. As much as you blow at it, nothing's going to happen. The piece of paper will not move. If our youths are made firm with the weight of knowledge, with the weight of hard evidence, with the weight of faith extracted and extrapolated from the Quran and the traditions of Ahlulbayt, we can rest assured that they will never be swayed. They will not shake up by the first twinkle and smile. If an infidel comes and sits next to them, and as hard as he blows at them, they will not fly away. They will always stand firm. To believe in the Almighty Allah is the bedrock of Islamic faith. And the reason I'm saying this is because the verse that I made my focus during these 10 nights, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى. He who does good, be it male or female, وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ فَلَنُحْيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبَةً. If you do good, and you're a man or a woman, doesn't matter, while you are a faithful, while you have faith. If you don't have faith, I mean seriously, I once mentioned this example to a group of friends. Someone showed me a video about nature. And, you know, it was one of those documentaries that's very well photographed and filmed. And it was very, very well done. And at the end he said to me, well, what did you think about that? Was that good? I said, that was beautiful. You know, amazing. The techniques that were used and how they went under the surface of the ocean and filmed all those different weird-looking creatures. And that was very, very nice. Except there was one problem. The problem with this documentary is that it doesn't mention the creator of the natural world that the documentary tries to document. This is like reading a book, and the book is marvelous. It's a beautiful work of art. A literary masterpiece. But then when I ask you who's the author of the book, you tell me, I'm not going to tell you who's the author of the book. Or there is no author of the book. Now that, you know, it really devalues the entire effort into reading the book or watching the documentary. This whole world, my friends, is but a big, beautiful book. What's really important is after you read the book and you enjoy it, and you're welcome to enjoy every bit of it within the guidelines and restrictions of Islam, but after that you should also realize all along as you're reading the book that the book was written by an all-powerful, all-merciful, omniscient, omnipotent creator called Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you come to that realization that the world does have a creator, you also ask yourself the question, what is my position in this world? We as humans are very insignificant. We're very small. As much as we try to boast, as much as we try to, you know, blow our horns, as they say, as much as we try to show off as being, you know, powerful human beings, and inshallah I'll talk more about that in the subsequent nights, as much as we do that, we are nothing, really. We have nothing. While we possess, we really don't possess anything. Imam Hussain, peace and blessings be upon him, has a very beautiful supplication known as the supplication of the day of Arafah. Those of you who have had the honor to perform the pilgrimage to Hajj and stood in the desert of Arafat on the ninth day of Dhul-Hijjah, most likely you've recited that supplication. You read the supplication, it is unbelievable. I myself tried elsewhere to give a series of lectures about the supplication, and as much as you read every single word in the supplication requires, you know, a separate speech and a lecture to talk about and to expound and to explain. Imam Hussein sat there on the day of Arafah, and he sat like a small peasant, you know, the way a beggar on the street would humble and humiliate himself for someone who is wealthy walking by, you know, a wealthy person's walking by, or a king or a prince is driving by. A beggar would humble and humiliate himself as much as possible in order to attract the sympathy of that king or of that wealthy person. And he raised his hand again in humility and in humbleness towards the Almighty Allah, and he began to recite the supplication. In one of the sections of that supplication, the beginning of the second section, Imam Hussein, peace and blessings be upon him, says, Ilahi, ana al-faqir fi ghinai, fakayfa la akunu faqiran fi faqri. O Allah, O my Lord, I am poor when I am fit, when I am wealthy. So how could I not be poor when I am poor? You know, you think about it, what do you possess? You know, you've got your car, for example. You have, maybe if you're lucky, you have your house. You have your clothes, to say the very least. You've got your watch, you have your bag, you've got your wallet, you have your credit card, you've got your bank account. But think about it, you really don't own any of those things. If you did own them, why would you leave them behind once you depart this world? All you take along with you. SubhanAllah, there's a very nice tradition where a person who dies, in this tradition the Imam exemplifies a person who has just passed away, and he conducts these conversations with the people around him, his immediate family members and his possessions. He says to his sons, for example, to his immediate family, he says to them, where are you leaving me? Because they bring him to the brink of his grave and they leave him there. His friends depart once the body is near the grave. And he says to his friends, where are you going? I've been with you all my life. And they tell him, no, this is as close as we are going to get to your grave. From now on, you're on your own. So they leave him. And then he talks to his sons and he says, I spent my life trying to feed you. I did everything I did. I stole, I deceived, I committed sins so that you would be happy. And they say to him that we are only going to take your body and place you in your grave, but we're not going to stay with you after that. We might stay for a little while after you're buried, but not any longer. And then he looks at his possessions and he says, his money, for example, his house and everything he owns. And he says, I did everything for you. I spent so much energy so that I could possess you. And his money says to him that the only thing I will let you take is your shroud. A piece of white, cheap, worthless cloth. I'll let you take that, but nothing else. Oh, that's right. All the millions, all the money, all the jewelry, everything we own will be left for the inheritors. And it's the inheritors that will enjoy that money. We will simply depart and leave everything behind. What we own, we really do not own. إِلَهِ أَنَا الْفَقِيرُ فِي غِنَاي فَكَيْفَ لَا أَكُونُ فَقِيرًا فِي فَقْرِي. Alright, leave the possessions, leave the money, leave the jewelry. The least I own is my body, right? You don't even own that. Why is it that you get sick? The least I own is my soul and my consciousness. You don't own your consciousness. Why is it that you lose it when you go to sleep? You sleep, you lose your consciousness altogether. So you don't even own that. You cannot maintain a conscious level at all times. You can't do that. Your conscience is taken away from you. And it's mandatory. There's nothing you can do about it. We don't own anything. إِلَهِ أَنَا الْفَقِيرُ فِي غِنَايِ. And then he continues to say, إِلَهِ أَنَا الْجَاهِلُ فِي عِلْمِي فَكَيْفَ لَا أَكُونُ جَهُولًا فِي جَهْلِي. Oh Allah, I am ignorant when I am knowledgeable. So how could I not be ignorant when I am ignorant? I don't know if you've ever seen this or if it's ever happened to you, but sometimes people actually forget their own names. You know, and they ring the bell of your house and you say, who is it? And they seem to forget their names. It's actually happened to me. And subhanAllah, for some reason, they forget their names, but somehow they're able to actually construct the sentence, I forgot my name. I don't know how it happens, but I just think that these are glimpses of Allah trying to show us, you don't have anything of your own. You even lose that little bit of knowledge that you were born with. Our name is something that we've owned since our moment of birth, and yet we manage to forget that. We manage to lose that bit of information that's been burnt into our brains. Even that is lost. إِلَهِ أَنَا الْجَاهِلُ فِي عِلْمِي. When I think I'm knowledgeable, I get on the pulpit, I give these speeches, and I think I'm good. I own nothing. This is taken away from me. It was given to me as a gift. If I use it, it will stay. If I abuse it, it will be taken away. Which is why we have traditions that if you learn something, if you learn things about your faith, for example, but you don't apply them, that will be taken away from you. You'll forget whatever you learned. It won't happen overnight, it'll take a while, but then finally you will have nothing. إِلَهِ أَنَا الْجَاهِلُ فِي عِلْمِي فَكَيْفَ لَا أَكُونُ جَهُولًا فِي جَهْلِي. And then Imam Hussein says, he starts to converse with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a marvelous manner. He says, إِلَهِ أَنْتَ الَّذِي أَنْعَمْتَ أَنْتَ الَّذِي أَعْطَيْتَ أَنْتَ الَّذِي أَكْرَمْتَ أَنْتَ الَّذِي مَنَنْتَ أَنْتَ الَّذِي رَحِمْتَ أَنْتَ الَّذِي تَحَنَّنْتَ. Oh Allah, you are the one who gave me. You are the one who had mercy on me. You are the one who bestowed onto me all your gifts. You were the one who overlooked my sins. And then he starts to talk about his relationship with Allah, about our relationship with Allah. And he says, إِلَهِ أَنَا الَّذِي أَذْنَبْتْ أَنَا الَّذِي تَعَمَّتْ أَنَا الَّذِي شَرَأْتْ أَنَا الَّذِي أَخْطَأْتْ. You were that good and I am this bad. I am the one who sinned. I am the one who transgressed. I am the one who defied your orders. I am the one who didn't apply your injunctions. I am the one who was such a bad slave while you were such a good Lord and Master. Once you come to realize that Allah is the creator of the world and that Allah created us from nothing and He brought us into this world and gave us a chance to make a difference to our miserable lives and to seek a place in His paradise in the vicinity of His mercy. Once you come to that realization, you come to appreciate the gifts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You come to love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, The whole discussion about the existence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we'll talk a little more about that in the subsequent nights. But I think before that, there's another question that we need to answer. The question is about religion in general. Sometimes some atheists challenge the religionists by such questions. And they say, why do we even need religion? And they ask you this question. If you know the answer, you're more than welcome to get up and give me the answer. If you dare, that is, you know, among all these people, over 1,000, you know, it is scary, I know. The question is this. Who is better? We've got two groups of people. Which one is better? The first does good in anticipation of a heavenly reward. When we give charity to the poor, why do we do it? Because we expect a return on that investment with interest in paradise on the day of judgment, right? That's why we do it. That's why we do good. One who does good in anticipation of heavenly rewards abstains from bad things because he fears hell. And one who does good things in general because the religion that he subscribes to says that he should do those things. Is this better? Or, contestant number two, is a person who does good for goodness' sake. Which one's better? When, you know, someone who doesn't believe in God, he doesn't believe in any religion, doesn't subscribe to any faith, he says, when I give charity to the poor, and you know, this is a pretty complex fallacy, and I don't want you to make up your mind before I give the answer. When I give charity to the poor, I don't believe in God, so I'm not going to believe in heaven or hell, so I give charity because I feel sorry for the poor. Whereas you give charity because you expect God to give you something in return. Am I better or you? Well, the answer to this fallacy, there are more than one ways to respond to it, but I'll focus on a few points. First of all, belief in a system of faith and subscription to a religion is the only guaranteed deterrent from committing evil. And it is the only way you can encourage people to do good things at all times. You will notice that some governments, you know, governments are in place in order to maintain security and to have a society that functions properly. Now, you will never see a government that relies, for example, on the sound judgment, in quote-unquote, of its citizens to abide by the law. This is why law enforcement agencies exist. That's what they do. They enforce the law. You'll never have a government without a police force. You'll never see a government without a military force. All governments have laws. And to enforce the existence and to enforce that their citizens will abide by the laws, they have law enforcement agencies. That's why civil authorities, they build roads and then they don't appeal to people's consciousness in order to abide by traffic laws. That's why you have cops all over the place. That's why you have traffic lights. That's why you have red light cameras. That's why you have speed cameras. Why? Because they can't appeal to people's consciousness. Oh, please, you know, we've given you these roads. You have those cars. But could we also ask you for one last thing? Please abide by the law. That will never happen. Why? It's simple. Because if I was late for a job interview, if I was late and I knew that there were no cops around, no speed or red light cameras around to capture my the number of my number plates, if I knew that, I wouldn't hesitate or think twice about crossing the red light if I didn't see cars around. When there's a conflict of interest, people choose their own interest. No one says, all right, oh, look, you know, the government said, please do this, so I'll do it for them. For them, okay. No one does that. Governments never rely on such a mentality because it simply doesn't exist. Now, without religion, without faith, without a proper merit-demerit system, without a proper educational system through the licensing, procedures. You know, the governments, they educate the public, they give licenses, they have merit, demerit points, they have traffic lights, they have police enforcing the laws, because they know that when it comes to my interest, when it is at stake, when I'm late for that interview, when I'm late for my speech, I will do whatever it takes to break, even if that means breaking every law, to do what I have to. When my desire is at stake, I will breach the sanctity of every other person on earth to satisfy my desire. That is the way the human consciousness and the human mind is built to be. That's the first thing. So without religion, we can't guarantee that you will give charity. Number one. Number two, and this is an even more important response to the fallacy, is that the problem is that we lack a universally acceptable definition of goodness. You know, I know this is getting a little bit, you know, philosophical and everything, but I think it's important to discuss the theoretical aspects of our faith, so that when it comes to the practical side, we don't hesitate and we know exactly what to do. The second answer to that question, who's better, someone who does good for goodness' sake or someone who does good because God said so? The second answer is this. There exists not a universally acceptable definition of goodness. We don't know what is good until there is an absolute moral standard that says this is good, that is bad. Because things keep changing. Your good might be my bad. In one society, something's good. In another society, it's bad. And let me give you this example. I think it'll make it very clear. Back in the pre-Islamic era, in the pagan times before the revelation of the Son of Islam, at the hands of our great Prophet, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Back in that time, the pagan Arabs used to consider the conception of a baby girl in the family to be a sign of shame. And what they did, and in fact Allah talks about that in the Holy Quran, talks about this phenomenon, because of its cruelty and mercilessness, what they did was when one of them got news that their wives, for example, his wife just gave birth to a baby girl, he would rush to bury that girl alive in order to prevent shame from reaching the family when that girl, say for example, was enslaved during a tribal war. Because they used to have a lot of wars. A lot of wars. Sometimes some of the wars would go on for 400 years between two tribes until the subsequent generations would forget why the war even started. And when they asked each other, they would say, yeah, there was this old lady and she had a goat, and one person from the other tribe, he took the goat and he milked it and he drank from the milk, and so, you know, that was seen as a bad gesture, and so the war erupted and it went on for 400 years. Now, the Arabs used to think that, well, we're going to have all these wars, there's nothing we can do about them. Instead of thinking how to stop the wars and how to prevent them, they thought about the ramifications and the repercussions of the war. And so they said, this girl that I have just been given, this girl might one day be enslaved by another tribe during a war. And that will bring shame to my family. So let me bury her alive. Bury her alive so that this would never take place. Now that act, despite its cruelty, we all know that it was cruel. We all know that it was barbarian. We all know that it was merciless. We all know how bad it is today. But back then, this was seen as a very good act of honor. Right? Today it's bad because the Prophet said so. The Prophet revived our intellects. Not because he said this was bad and so we accepted it. No, because he revived the intellect. لِيُثِيرُوا لَهُمْ دَفَائِنَ الْعُقُولِ وَلِي يُذَكِّرُوهُمْ مَنْ سِيَّ نِعْمَتِهِ. This was the mission of the prophets. They came in order to revive the intellect, and so that you and I could sit here today and curse those who buried their daughters alive. One person, let me just tell you this story, came up to the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him and upon his holy progeny, and he said, O Prophet of Islam, I did something terrible. And now I want to repent. I want to seek forgiveness and I want to become a Muslim. The Prophet said, what was that? He said, well, one day I was living with my wife. We were married for a while. And I had to take a journey outside my city. And so I packed up and I left. My journey actually lasted for 5 years. You know, because they used to get up from Arabia and go all the way to China, for example. And it would take that long sometimes. After 5 years, I came back and I saw a girl, a five-year-old girl, living in the house. So immediately I asked my wife, who is this girl? She said, oh, she's just a neighbor's daughter. You know, she sometimes comes here, we're used to each other. Fair enough. He stayed, and then he noticed that the girl was always around. You know, she always showed up. And so he began to suspect that this was in fact his daughter, because he remembered that at the time he left his wife, she was pregnant. And eventually he found out by asking his wife or something, and he found out that this was in fact his own daughter. So he did exactly what everybody else at that time would have done. He took the hand of that five-year-old innocent daughter and he took her out to the desert. He started, and this is, he's telling the Prophet this story. He said, I started digging a pit in the ground, and she was actually helping me. You know, she was really excited about meeting her father for the first time and so forth. And she started helping me in digging that pit. And after the pit was large enough, I simply pushed her into the pit and started pouring the soil back onto her. And she would cry and say, Father, why are you doing this? She doesn't understand what's happening. Father, why are you doing this? Why are you doing this? Until I buried her alive. Once he finished telling the story, I remember I once told this story in a group, and someone sitting down said, La'natullah alayhi, curse the man. And I said, no, don't be hasty, because actually he ended up becoming a Muslim and he repented. But as he was telling the story to the Prophet was shedding his tears onto his beard. And he was, you know, the Prophet being such a merciful person, full of compassion, he cried so much. But because this person was ignorant, he was a pagan, nomadic, anarchistic Arab, and he was doing everything he did out of pure ignorance, the Prophet accepted his submission to the religion of Islam. So this was seen as a good thing back in that time. But today we know it's bad. There is no universally acceptable definition of goodness. You might say, I do good for goodness' sake. But who says what's good and what's not? Something that's good in my culture might be bad in your culture, or vice versa. Another example, probably a more contemporary example, is how homosexuality is perceived in the modern world. Homosexuality today is tolerated. Yet only 50 years ago, you could go to the United States, for example, to Philadelphia, to Sydney, to all those, you know, the major centers of homosexuality, and homosexuals were seen as evil people. The act itself was seen as a very, very evil act. They were punished for it. Which is why when AIDS was discovered, it used to be called gay-related disease or something. It was actually labeled after gay people. And only after the homosexual community demonstrated and they had all these public demonstrations that the name was changed into AIDS, acquired immunodeficiency syndrome. So the point is, homosexuality was seen as a bad thing 50 years ago. Today it's good. Today pedophilia is bad. Tomorrow could be good. Today incest, in other words fornication with immediate family members, between a brother and a sister for example, a father and a daughter, that is a bad, evil thing. But who knows what's going to happen tomorrow? Only God knows how things will shift. Because our morality, unfortunately, is governed by the media and governments. Whatever the media says is good, is good. Tomorrow, Rupert Murdoch changes, someone else comes, and he decides that something that was bad is good, and so that changes back again. The governments say alcohol is banned in the 1920s in the United States. Alcohol was actually banned, so it was bad. Today, it's good. Then they tell you, oh no, while driving, it's bad. Tomorrow they tell you, oh no, at home, it's bad. And so, things keep shifting and changing from one value into another. And you know, there is nothing that is absolute. Something that is fixed, something that doesn't change. And sometimes, you know, it's even amusing to see people in the legal profession. They would tell you that, of course, you know, that's the nature of law. Things could be banned today, but tomorrow they're legalized. In 200 years' time, pedophilia and incest might become good, and there's nothing we can do about it because it's the will of the people. Power to the people. The people are the ones that choose what's good and what's bad. So in 200 years' time, incest could become good. I don't want to be living in that time. When things actually, bad things become good, you know. Na'udhu billah, we seek refuge in Allah. When God is omitted from our vocabulary, when religion is taken out of our lives, this is exactly what you get. People doing things as they will, and there's nothing that stops them. So there is no universally acceptable definition of goodness. You tell me I'm good for goodness' sake? That's nothing but a joke, a paradox. You cannot be good, because good keeps shifting. Good becomes bad. So you become bad for badness' sake. Islam is a fixed system, a fixed moral system. Now, of course, Islam actually, you know, there was a very deep discussion into the compatibility between Islam and modernity, but that's not something I want to discuss tonight. We don't want to take too much time, but how Islam is in fact compatible with modernity in its literal sense. Modernity is the invention of new ways and techniques to do old things. So, for example, if, you know, people have a need to communicate. But the communication evolves. So we start off in the, you know, in the old ages, people would talk using verbal gestures. They would talk, they would use language. But then they would evolve and they would invent the telephone, the facsimile, email, instant messaging, you know, and that keeps evolving. So it's the techniques that keep evolving, not the essence of human interaction. It's not the communication itself. In that sense, Islam has no problem with modernity. But for someone to make the sinister call that Islam's core teachings must change because they are outdated, in quote-unquote, that is something that we simply cannot accept. They tell you Islam is old. It's 1400 years old. And so it's, you know, it's irrelevant at this age. We need to be modern. We need to invent a new religion. That is unacceptable. Because simply for something to be old doesn't mean that it's irrelevant and useless. The universe is 5 billion years old. And it's running as efficiently as ever. Does that mean that we need to change the universe, go and, you know, to another universe simply because it's old? Again, back to that fallacy, there are other responses. Briefly, when we seek rewards in exchange for good deeds, that doesn't make the good deeds any less valuable. This is why Olympic athletes are given medals. They're given gold medals, for example. Does that make them any less valuable in terms of their profession as athletes? No. Because rewards encourage competition. And when people compete, you will see the good talent surface. And so that's why you reward them in exchange for that. You give them medals. You recognize their abilities. So there's nothing wrong with seeking rewards in the Day of Judgment. Imam Ali says to Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein in his final will, he says, قُولَا بِالْحَقِّ وَعْمَلَا لِلْأَجْرِ. Say what is true and act for rewards, in exchange for rewards. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you. And it's within human nature to want to be rewarded. I do something and I ask Allah the Almighty, I ask Him by His mercy, I ask Him by His generosity, I ask Him by His grace to reward me. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said over and over again, Ud'uni astajib lakum, ask me and I will respond to you. Now some people say, alright, why is it that sometimes when I ask Allah, my prayers are not answered? Well, as one scholar put it, the problem is either in ud'u or in ni. Ud'u ni astajib lakum. It's either in the prefix, in the first part of the letter, the word, or in the second part. You are either not praying properly, you are either not asking properly, or you're not asking Allah. You're sick. You ask Allah to cure you, But what you really rely on is that medication the doctor gave you today. And there's nothing wrong with that. You know, to use medication, to use means to getting to our goals, there's nothing wrong with that. But you should always recognize that it was Allah who created us, He gave us the means, He helped us, and He gave us the knowledge to reach the highest levels in medicine and in, you know, pharmaceuticals and to create the medicine. So you should always recognize that. Now, finally, belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as we said, is the bedrock. It is important to believe in Allah in order to create that moral standard, that standard that does not change. As I said, in Islam, there are the fundamental core teachings of Islam do not change. For example, that you should be truthful, that you should be good to others, that you should, for example, have two parties in a financial transaction. Those are things that don't change. That you should not deceive others. That's something that's fixed. However, there are things in Islam that do change. But it's not the laws that change, it is the external factors attached to them that change. For example, praying is good. It's not only good, it's obligatory. You have to pray, right? However, we are also told that if you are praying somewhere, and there's a pool next to you, you see a little kid walking towards the pool, then falling into it. And the kid starts to scream, and to ask for help, and you continue to pray, Allah will take you into hellfire because you prayed instead of going to save that kid. Praying is a great thing, but there are always exceptions. When there is a greater good to be salvaged, you go and save that kid because life is respected in Islam. That's one example. The other example, some scholars say that the majority, the consensus of the scholars is that a girl, for example, becomes mature and has to start observing the Islamic laws when she's at the age of 9, right? That's something that we all know. However, some scholars say that this is only because back in the 6th century, at the time of the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him and his progeny, girls used to reach puberty at the age of 9. Now, because of various climatic changes, nowadays girls don't reach puberty at that age most of the time. They reach puberty at the age of 13, for example. And I'm only saying this because there's no shame in religion. This is about our faith. At the age of 13, they reach puberty. So some scholars say, and you know, in regards to your own scholar, you need to consult him, but some scholars that I know say that a girl is not obliged to fulfill her duties as a Muslim woman until she reaches puberty, until she reaches physical maturity. It's not about the age. Instead of specifying an age, Islam says there is a natural physical phenomenon called puberty. Once that happens, once that takes place, a girl is obliged to become, you know, a law-abiding, God-fearing Muslim. So there are things that are subject to change in Islam, but they are attached to external issues, and that is, you know, a long discussion. But back to the absolute moral standard. Without religion, my friends, this is a really important thing I'm trying to say here. Without religion, there is no limit as to how low we can get. Let me give you an example and try to wrap up the speech. There's no limit as to how low we can sink. I don't know if you've heard about this, but about 6 months ago, probably less than that, a new rock group emerged in the United States by the name of Hell on Earth. Some of you might have heard about it because there was a big controversy about it. This rock band, what they did, I mean, I even saw pictures of them. It is absolutely gruesome, absolutely disgusting. They get up on the stage, and as they're playing their music, they put a giant living rat, you know, one of those big rats that even scare the cats. They take those rats, they put them, while they're alive, they put them in a blender, okay? They blend them until they become rat juice, then they drink them. Disgusting, isn't it? But not to them. It's disgusting to you, but not to them. And I saw pictures of this same rock group. They actually take the skinned head of a cow, they bring the whole cow, they skin it, They take the skin off, then they cut the head, and they put that head into the blender again, and they, you know, mix it with all herbs and spices and chili and all that kind of thing, and then they drink it. Not only that, the reason the controversy erupted, the reason this rock group actually came on the surface wasn't that. You know, that's something that any disgusting, filthy person might do. But the reason they were prosecuted by the law and prevented from broadcasting their music sessions on the internet and their concerts on the internet was because they announced one day, and again, this was all over the news at the time, they announced one day that they will bring a terminally ill patient, one of their fans who was sick for a long time, they will bring him on the stage while they play the music and get him to commit suicide through a form of asphyxiation while they played the music. Someone committing suicide right next to them in front of the crowds while they enjoyed the music and the person's killing himself? Through asphyxiation, some sort of, you know, suffocation? There is no limit, my friends, as to how low we can sink. If there is no God out there, if we don't accept the God out there that says to us, do and don't. A'udhu billah. Go back to the early history of Islam. I'm not going to talk about the first khulafa. But let's talk about Muawiyah. Muawiyah was a man, you know, the son of Abu Sufyan. Abu Sufyan was the instigator against the Prophet. He was the man who would group all the pagans together and get them to fight the Prophet. He was the man responsible for most, if not all, of the wars waged against the Prophet. Now, he gave birth to a son with his wife, Hind. And Hind was the woman who chewed on the liver of Hamza, the uncle of the Prophet of Islam. This was Hind. This was the mother, this was the father, and so this was the final product, Muawiyah. When Muawiyah came, obviously he was made the governor of the Sham province by the second Khalifa. My friends, before I continue, the atrocious murder of Imam Hussein was no accident. It was no fluke of nature. It was not a giant space asteroid that fell into Karbala without prior warning. When there is smoke, there has to be a fire. The second Khalif made him the governor. And then the third Khalif came and he reinstated him. Muawiyah came. This was a man that during the Battle of Safin, as you all know, his army fought the army of the commander of the faithful, Imam Ali, peace and blessings be upon him. And they eventually killed Ammar ibn Yasir, one of the most prominent and respectable companions of the Prophet of Islam. When that happened, there was a huge division made within the ranks of Muawiyah's army. Why? Because the Prophet had foretold, when they were building the mosque of the Prophet in Medina, the Prophet said to Ammar, Ammar, taqtuluka al-fi'atu al-baghiyah. تَدْعُوهُمْ إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ فَيَدْعُونَكَ إِلَى النَّارِ The group of aggressors will kill you, O Ammar. You will call them into heaven while they call you into hell. Now this tradition is being stated in Sahih al-Bukhari and all the major Sunni books. And so there was no doubt or suspicion as to the raw nature of the army of Muawiyah to kill Ammar. When they killed him, they became the group of aggressors. And so Muawiyah had to come up with, you know, some kind of trick or plan to rectify the problem. What did he do? He said, we're not the ones that killed Ammar. It was Ali that killed him. Why? Because he brought him into the battlefield. He brought him to fight with us. And so when we killed him, it wasn't actually us. The main cause for his death was Imam Ali. SubhanAllah. You know, I can't even believe they fell for that. We didn't kill him, it was Ali that killed him. So when the news of that got to Imam Ali alayhi salam, he answered, you know, he gave the best rebuttal. You know what he said? He said, then that means that Hamza was killed by the Prophet because he was the one who took him to fight the infidels. And the reason I believe Imam Ali mentioned Hamza is to remind the people that it was the mother of this same person that chewed on Hamza's liver. She was the one who paid the slave Wahshi to kill Hamza. Did the Prophet kill Hamza because he brought him into the war? And then Muawiyah, you know, seeing that this didn't really work, he made a new trick. And he said, look, true, the Prophet said, تَقْتُلُهُ الْفِئَةُ الْبَاغِيَةُ. But baghiya doesn't actually mean aggression. Baghi doesn't mean aggression. Baghi means to want. And this is another meaning for the word, incidentally. In Arabic, you could say, أَبْغِي هَذَا. In other words, I want this. Or بَغَى عَلَيْهِ means he aggressed upon someone. So he said, al-baghiya doesn't mean the aggressor. But baghiya means what? The people who want. Now, what do we want? We want to avenge the blood of Uthman. You know, they were always holding this this shirt of Uthman saying, oh, we want to avenge the blood of Uthman. They did everything they did in the name of the blood of Uthman. Muawiyah was one of Uthman's most bitter enemies. Yet, when he saw the chance, he just waved his shirt around the nation saying, I want to avenge the blood of Uthman. So, Muawiyah said that, what do we want? We want the blood, to avenge the blood of Uthman. But subhanAllah, the Prophet had already refuted this misconception. How? The Prophet said, تَقْتُلُكَ الْفِئَةُ الْبَاغِيَةُ. The group of aggressors kill you, you call them into paradise and they call you towards hell. We want to avenge. Come on, for God's sakes. This was Muawiyah. And then on the way back from Safin, and the people he led were really in that sort of mentality to accept everything that he said. They really were that low in terms of their intelligence. Which is why on the way back from Safin, and this is something that Al-Mas'udi, who is one of their, you know, most prominent historians in his book, Muruj al-Dhahab, he tells this story, and the one that I said to you before. And he said on the way back from Safin, it was Wednesday, and Muawiyah called his troops to gather around and to pray the Friday prayers. And no one said to him, it's Wednesday, what are you doing praying the Friday prayers and giving the Friday sermons? They were that low in terms of their intelligence and their ability to question, that they followed him like sheep, and no one ever doubted this man's eligibility to lead and to become the Khalifa of Rasulullah. This was the type of person that fought Imam Ali. This was the type of person that battled Imam al-Hasan. This was the type of person that gave birth to Yazid ibn Muawiyah, who eventually killed Imam al-Hussein. The death of Imam Hussein, my friends, my good brothers and sisters, was not an accident. It was not something that took place within 24 hours in a snap. It wasn't like that. This was a socio-political catastrophe that took place over several generations. When did it start? It started exactly 50 years before the death and murder of Imam Hussein. Imam Hussein was killed on the year 61. On Friday, the 10th of Muharram, the year 61 on the Hijri calendar. Exactly 50 years before that, on the 28th, of the month of Safar, in the year 11 on the Hijri calendar, that sinister fetus which was born on the day of Ashura was conceived on that day. It was conceived 50 years ago. What happened on that day? It was a Monday. Lady Zainab, peace and blessings be upon her, when Imam Hussein had been killed, she came and approached the battered, butchered body of her brother Imam Hussein that was cut into pieces. She looked at him, she placed her hands beneath some of the pieces of his body, she raised them and says, As-salamu alayka ya qateel al-ithnain. Peace be upon you, O the martyr of Monday. It was a Friday. The day of Ashura was a Friday. Get the political and the social analysts and the historians to come and analyze the words of Lady Zainab, this great lady of Islam. Peace be upon you, O martyr of Monday. What happened on Monday in the year 11 on the Hijri calendar 50 years ago? The Prophet died and Islam derailed. Islam was like a train that was derailed from its main course. Why? Because the successor to the Prophet, his rights were usurped. Fatima al-Zahra was attacked and ambushed in her own house. Imam Ali was put aside, and someone proclaimed himself the successor to the Prophet. He writes a letter, incidentally, to one of the companions of the Prophet, Usama ibn Zayd. Usama, you might recognize him from the Prophet's famous words, لَعَنَ اللَّهُ مَنْ تَخَلَّفَ عَنْ جَيْشِ أُسَامَةَ. When the Prophet was about to die, he sent an army, and he said, may God curse those who do not join the army of Usama. And so there were people, all the companions, they left with that army, but then they got a signal that the Prophet's about to die, so two of them rushed back into Medina. And so they became cursed by the Prophet's own words. That person, obviously because he left the city, when the changes took place after the Prophet's demise, and the first Khalifa seized power, he sent a letter to Usama, and the letter began with these words, مِنْ خَلِيفَةِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ فُلَانِ إِلَىٰ أُسَامَةِ بْنِ زَيْدِ أَمَّا بَعْدْ لَقَدْ اجْتَمَعَ النَّاسُ عَلَيْهِ فَنَصَبُونِي أَمِيرًا عَلَيْهِمْ خَلِيفَةً عَلَيْهِمْ. To Usama ibn Zayd, from the successor of the Prophet, and he mentions his name, he says, people gathered around and they elected me as their leader. Usama sends back a letter and he says, you have contradicted yourself by yourself. First you say, I'm the successor to the Prophet. Then you say, people elected me to be the successor to the Prophet. I choose my own successor. The president chooses his own aides and his own government and his own ministers. You can't have someone choose and elect someone to succeed someone else. It's basic human logic. Imam Hussein's death was not an accident. It was not an accident. Fatima al-Zahra, peace and blessings be upon her, says in her sermon that was delivered to the women of Ansar. As you all know, Fatima al-Zahra delivered a beautiful sermon in the mosque. And then she delivered another sermon as she was about to die. She was bed stricken. She was about to pass away and die. Some women of the Ansar, some of the wives of the Ansar, they came to visit her in her house. When they came, she delivered a fascinating speech in which she said, أَمَّا لَعَمْرِي لَقَدْ لُقِحَتْ. She swears by herself and she says, it has been conceived. This camel, this cow has just been conceived. أَمَّا لَعَمْرِي لَقَدْ لُقِحَتْ فَنَظِرَةً إِلَىٰ رَيْثَمَا tuntage. This cow has just become impregnated. You have just made this camel or cow, the beautiful analogy that she uses, it's just become pregnant. And it's waiting until the day when it delivers. When that happens, فَحْلِبْ ثُمَّ حْلِبُوهَا مِلْءَ الْقَعْبِ دَمًا عَبِيطًا. When she delivers, you have to go back and you will try to milk this cow, but instead of milk, you will get a bowl full of blood that flows out. Instead of milk, you'll get blood. وَدُعَافًا مُرِيبًا. And you will get blood and poison. That's what you'll get. فَأَبْشِرُوا بِسَيْفٍ صَارِمٍ. Cheer up and wait up for a sword that cuts through. Wait up for the sword. She gives four warnings as to what's going to happen in the future. You didn't need a crystal ball to get a forecast of what was going to take place 50 years from the Prophet's death. It was all clear what this was going to lead to. Fatima al-Zahra says, فَأَبْشِرُوا بِسَيْفٍ صَارِمٍ. Wait up for that sword when it strikes you. فَأَبْشِرُوا بِسَيْفٍ صَارِمٍ وَبِمُعْتَدٍ غَاشِمٍ. And also wait for an aggressive force that will come and destroy you. and an anarchy that will take hold of the nation. Subhanallah, hasn't all this happened? The sword that killed Imam Ali, the sword that killed Imam Al-Hussein, the sword that made Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf al-Thaqafi kill 150,000 people in Iraq alone, 150,000. And he didn't have the technology that Saddam had, which is why Saddam managed to actually top that up and eventually kill over 4 million people. That is the sword Fatima al-Zahra foretold. فَأَبْشِرُوا بِسَيْفٍ صَارِمٍ وَبِمُعْتَدٍ غَاشِمٍ. And then she says, فَيَا أَسَفًا عَلَيْكُمْ. Alas, unto you. I feel sorry, but this is the act of your own hands. This is what you did. You conceived the baby on the day of the Prophet's demise. This baby was born 50 years later when Imam Hussein, the master of the youth of paradise, the grandson of the Holy Prophet of Islam, this graded person, this fifth member of the five group of God's greatest servants, when he was killed on that day, it was not a fluke of nature, which is why this led to the Ahlulbayt crying all their lives. Imam al-Jawad, as it was his father passing away, he came up to him and said, "Assalamu alayka ya qatil al-ithnain." Again, you have been killed on Monday, even though it was Tuesday. It was not an accident. Ahlul Bayt cried and cried and cried. Imam Hussein himself cried for himself. Imam Rida, peace and blessings be upon him, says, "Inna yawm al Hussein aqraha jufunana wa asbala dumu'ana wa adalla azizana wa awrathana al karb wal bala fi ard karb wa bala." He says, "The day of Hussein wounded our hearts, caused our tears to shed, and he humiliated and humbled our noble ones in a land of anguish and tribulation. And he inherited us, he left us with anguish and tribulation." Imam Zain al-Abidin cried for over 30 years. He cried upon his father. Every time they brought him food, he would cry until the food would mix with his tears. Every time they brought him water, he would cry and weep until the water would be mixed with his tears. Every time he would walk in the streets and see a sheep is about to be slaughtered, he would run towards the owners and ask them if they had offered any water to that sheep. Because these are Islamic morals. When you're about to slaughter an animal, you offer water to that animal. Imam Zain al-Abidin would go up to the owners and say, "Did you offer this animal any water?" They would say, "Yes, of course we did." He says, "But my father was killed while he was thirsty. My father was killed while he was hungry. And therefore he cried and cried and cried so much so that Abu Hamza Thumali, one of his closest companions, as well as his father's, he comes to Imam Zain al-Abidin one day and he says, "Ya Sayyidi, ama ana li bukaika an yantahi." Isn't it the day that you should stop crying? Isn't it enough? You've cried for 20 years, for 30 years. Isn't it enough already? أَلَيْسَ الْمَوْتُ لَكُمْ عَادَةٌ وَكَرَامَتُكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ الشَّهَادَةِ. Is death not a honor for you? Is martyrdom anything but a God-given gift to you? Imam Zain al-Abidin then looked at him and said, "Ya Aba Hamza, شكر الله سعيك." "Thank you, Ya Aba Hawza. Thank you very much. Thank you for your concern. I appreciate that." "ولكن يا أبا حمزة هل سمعت أذناك أو رأت عيناك ما حل بكربلاء؟ أبا حمزة, you were not there on the day of Ashura when my sisters and my aunt tents were running from a tent to another tent, a burning tent to another burning tent, fleeing those vicious men trying to take a hold of them, to hit them, to take their possessions. It is true, Ya Aba Hamza, death it is to us, but an honor. And martyrdom is to us a God-given gift. But you were not there on the day of Ashura when my aunts and my sisters were taken captive. Ya Aba Hamza, Galbi Ya Aba Hamza, Tara. تفطر وذايا يا قلبي يا ابو حمزة ترى تفطر وذايا مثل المصيبة اللي دهايتنا ما حد صايب حرقة وخيمنا وسيرة زينب أسيرة حرقة وخيمنا وسيرة زينب سبية شحشي يا ابو حمزة وشخا عبر من الرزية لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون إلهنا إنا نسألك وندعوك باسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم يا الله 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 اللهم إنا نسألك بحق فاطمة وأبيها وبعلها وبنيها والسر المستودع فيها أن تعجل فرج إمام زماننا يا الله اللهم واجعلنا من أصحابه وأعوانه وشيعته ومحبيه والذابين عنه والممتثلين لأوامره ونواهيه اللهم اقض حوائجنا وحوائج المؤمنين والمؤمنات شاف مرضانا يا الله أعدنا إلى أوطاننا سالمين إلى سالمين اللهم أد ديوننا تقبل منا أعمالنا ومن المؤسسين تقبل منهم هذا العمل الصالح يا الله اللهم احفظ وأيد وسدد علماءنا العاملين ومراجعنا العظام يا الله اللهم وارحم موتانا وموتى المؤمنين وإلى أرواحهم نهدي ثواب سورة الفاتحة مع الصلوات